Morning.
Ooh, good morning. I got the nod that it was time to start, and I was like, I'm not ready. All right, but I'm going to get ready. Welcome to the Salvation Army Ingle Farm this morning. It is wonderful to have you all with us today. Do you know that you were created in the likeness of our God? Do you believe that Jesus was the King of Kings, is the King of Kings? Do you believe that you have been invited into the family of God? Then I would like for you to turn to the person beside you or behind you and say, to come. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Let's worship God together. I will not ask you to leave the events of the week at the door, because God invites all of us, as we are, to enter his courts. And we're going to do that with both praise and thanksgiving. Before we sing our first song, I want to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet, which is the Kaurna people. And I want to pay my respects to their elders, past, present and emerging. As we remind ourselves as the Salvation Army and members of the Salvation Army that we believe in a God of reconciliation and therefore will partner with God at every possible opportunity to do so. We are going to sing our first song, which is Lord of Creation, to you be all praise. Most mighty your working, most wondrous your ways. Those of you who know me, and I don't keep this a secret at all, will know that plants are terrified of me. I walk into a room and plants die. It's just what happens. My father was an amazing gardener, and when he passed away, he took all talent with him and left me with none. I love lilies, and last year I got a lily. I think it was for Valentine's Day or our anniversary or for something, and true enough, I killed it. It died. However, I was so attached to this plant that it sat, the pot full of dirt sat on a lovely counter we have at home, knowing that at one stage it had life. Anyway, 2 weeks ago, a green shoot appeared. Throwing it out was a bad idea. I'm glad I kept it. And as of today, we've got 5 lilies that are standing this tall in this pot. I had no idea that there was life sitting in this dirt, creation and potential. And I say it was unrealized potential because I nearly threw it out several times. Imagine that poor lily now. I can't wait to see the growth and the life that will come from that. So when I think of creation, when I think of the mighty working and wondrous ways, I do think of the world around us, but I also have to think of me. And I pray that you too think of you. So I'm going to invite you to stand. We're going to sing the first 2 verses. Let's stand together. creation, Lord of all power. And the third verse, Lord of all wisdom, I give you my mind. It's a big ask. I don't know about you, but my mind barely stops for the Lord to use it because it's just going, and it's usually going because I want it to. Rich truth that surpasses man's knowledge to find. What eye has not seen and what ear has not heard is taught by your Spirit and shines from your word. Are you expecting the Spirit to speak to you today? Have you come expecting? Have you come going, I know I will hear from God today? A challenge. We're going to sing Lord of all bounty and Lord of all being. It's such a beautiful tune. Thanks, Ben. Take seats, I invite us all to pray. Lord God, we thank you that you are the provider of all. Lord of creation, Lord of power, Lord of wisdom, Lord of bounty, Lord of all being. Lord, we ask your Holy Spirit to be really loud today, for your voice to be unmistaken, and for us to be able to know that you have already invested in us as your children. We pray these things in your precious name. Amen. Take your seats. Well, the almighty Greg of Good News is sharing in his own good news at the moment, and he's spending time in the Lord's creation. You can talk to Katrina about what that might look like after. And so Josh and I decided through rock, paper, scissors that I would be bringing the good news to you today. Thank you, Josh. I won. Because I love doing the good news. That's my story and I'm sticking with it. All right, I want to tell you that's really exciting. Today is National Vegemite Day. Yay! Hey! I hope you put Vegemite on everything you eat today. It's such a phenomenal thing. Tonight is Ladies' Night Out. So ladies, if you would like to go to the movies tonight and share in company and being together, you're off to see Unsung Hero. I have to say that my social media has been flooded with this movie and it has had some amazing, beautiful reviews. So if that's something that you would like to do, meet at 4:40 tonight. It's in the newsletter. I would also like to put two things in your diaries. The first is on Thursday, the 4th of July, which is, again, the end of term Just Brass concert. Can you believe that I'm saying end of term again? Gosh, time is flying. So please make yourselves available for that. I've only heard amazing things about the Just Brass concert. Also, which is, you know, we're talking here July, but now I want you to move your calendars a whole nother month again. And when I'm talking the 28th of August. Now, why would I be talking about something that far in advance now? Well, don't go on holidays because the General of the Salvation Army is holidaying with us. So please put it in your diaries. There's going to be a rally which is going to be held in the city at Adelaide Congress Hall, and we would love everyone to be there to hear from the General. For those of you who aren't aware, the General is our... losing my voice. The General is the international leader of the Salvation Army. He lives in England. And he and his wife will be over to worship with us. He's doing the national tour, honestly. That week we will pray that all domestic flights do their thing on time. I will be praying for that. Please be aware that there are lots of people that are quite unwell at the moment. This is peak flu and sickness season, and we have a lot of vulnerable people in our community. So when you spend time in prayer, a general prayer for the health of this community would be welcome, as people are fighting flus and COVID and all sorts of things that just keep coming back. So just pray for each other in this time, and be sensitive. If you have the sniffles or a cough, do the responsible thing is what I'm going to say to that. I'm now going to hand over to Kathy as she comes to talk about prayer.
Good morning, everybody. We're up to week 3 of the What Do You Want To Be? Or rather, what does God want you to be? So week 1 was be holy, week 2 was be satisfied, and this week is be faithful. We serve a faithful God. He never lets us down. We can always depend on Him, so we want to be like Him. And if we're going to reflect Him to the world, we need to be faithful, don't we? People need to know that we can be counted on. People need to know that we're there for them. Otherwise, why would they believe us when we share with them about Jesus? So there's bees to colour, there's scriptures to read, songs to help you to pray. So I encourage you to come and pray and ask God to help you be holy, help you be faithful, so that you can be satisfied in Him. Bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Howard. Let us pray. Father, what a blessing it is to lean on your everlasting arms. We thank you for that wonderful blessing that you have given to us. And so, Lord, in return, we would like to give back some of what you've given to us and pray, Lord, that you will use it to your glory in the paths of helping people in need and winning souls for you, we pray. So bless it, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, yes, good morning to the children of God, to the children of the kingdom. And we are going to make room for some younger children. We can shift that box, can't we? I think. Yes, Greg is strong enough, yes. Okay. Not too long. Okay. Now this is just for Erica, I think. Greg, what did you bring this morning?
Can I just sit up for
it? Yes, yeah. That's mine. You take that one. Okay. Right. I think we're ready. What did you bring this morning?
Well, I bought lots of stuff, and I left a microphone over here.
And that's right. Yes. A microphone will help.
Am I on?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I bought lots of stuff this morning. I've bought a plant in a pot, and it's a marshmallow. I didn't grow it.
Well, that's my bit. Did you grow that?
No, I found it in the creek.
You what?
I found it in the creek.
Yes, there's a creek opposite our house. Okay. So you didn't grow it on purpose?
No, weeds just grow. Weeds just grow. The seeds get blown by the wind, they land in our garden, in the soil, and as soon as they get some water, they grow. And I would suspect most of you have seen that action in your garden. And after a while, you can pick marshmallows.
Well, it's a marshmallow plant, so why not? We did bring some. There you go. If anybody would like a marshmallow after the meeting, there's a few in that packet.
These did grow on marshmallows in our garden, by the way. Just packaged them.
Okay. Right. Seriously, though, the Bible reading is not about marshmallows. Did you know that? Okay. Jesus did talk about seeds. In Mark chapter 4, which Roz is going to read to us in a little while, Jesus told a parable or a story about a mustard seed. Did you know that, Caden? The parable of the soil, that fits really well too. Yes. And the parable of the soil tells us that weeds do grow. Yes. He said that the mustard seed can teach us about the kingdom of heaven. So what do you think about that?
Well, I'm not prepared yet. I have to put a throne over there.
Right. Okay. Well, I'll ask the kids. When someone talks about a kingdom, what do you think of? A king, yes. Any of the children of God can answer. That's fine. A king. And what does a king have? A crown. Okay. Now, Greg was going to set up the throne. Okay.
You're not keeping to the script.
No. Oh, well. We hardly ever do. But it is a guide. Okay. So we've got a red velvet throne. And somebody said, a crown? We watched the coronation last year on telly, right? We've got some real gold jewellery here. that I found in a drawer. Yes, never mind. You get the picture. What else? Oh, the fur. It's not real fur, so don't worry.
It was when I bought it for you.
In the thrift shop. I have worn it to a couple of car runs and a fancy high tea, so it does have its uses. Okay, now, so, Caden, did you watch any of the coronation last year on TV? When they crowned the king? He had a special crown, he drove in a golden carriage. Okay, so, Jesus was talking to people and he said, right, we're going to talk about the kingdom of heaven. So, did Jesus talk about fur or velvet or gold crowns? No. Well, Greg, I think we've got to your bit.
Okay. There are things that remind us of the kingdom here on earth. The problem is that Jesus said to forget about all that stuff. He said that his kingdom is like a mustard seed.
Right. So, Greg, I need you to find me some mustard seeds.
Look on the jar there, dear.
Oh, yes, but... Okay, straight from the castle fridge. Okay, and that's something that kings have. They have castles, did you know that? Right? Okay, have you ever seen mustard like that? Are the seeds very big? No. And down there, I've got a packet of some that haven't been put in a jar. I don't know if we planted one of these, if they'd grow. Are they very big? Are they very, very sparkly or very grand? No. Jesus said, if you want to think about what the kingdom of heaven is like, you have to think about a mustard seed. Okay. Now, Greg, did those mustard seeds remind you of the kingdom of heaven?
Not really, but I'm sure you'll tell us why.
Yes, that's what we're here for. Now, Jesus told us, he said that the grain of mustard is one of the smallest of seeds, but when it's sown in the ground, it springs up and becomes the biggest of all the shrubs in the garden, providing shade and a home for the birds to make their nests. You see, the kingdom of heaven is all about faith and believing. Now, Greg specially made some gold. We forgot that.
Now that goes with the
crown. That goes with the earthly kingdom over here. Okay. So when people who don't have faith think about kingdoms, they think about riches and gold and power and money, all of those things. But Jesus said, he wasn't that sort of king. He's the mustard seed sort of king. So, the kingdom of heaven is a kingdom of faith. And what does the mustard seed do, Greg? It starts small. Yes. Can you find... Over there, we've actually got a sheet that says, start small. Yes. Greg likes this one.
These would be strung up, but I couldn't find any string. So.
Okay. Right? Other side? Oh, yes, that one's scribbled on. Start small. Okay. That's the first thing that the mustard seed does. It starts small. And that's what Christians do. We start small in our faith. So, after we start small, we have faith. We join the kingdom of faith and we become people of faith. And what do we do next? We grow. And as more of us join and more of us grow in faith, the kingdom becomes bigger and better and it stretches further and wider and it reflects our King. And the next thing, as the mustard tree grows into a big shrub, it shares its shade, its branches, it grows more mustard seeds, the birds have a home. So as we grow in faith, we share. And all of those things we need to remember come from the mustard seed. So we may all start small, but as we grow in faith, we belong to the kingdom of God's people. And somebody said a long time ago, and I have always remembered it, we're not about the physical. You see, Christians do not believe because they can see. They see because they believe. And that's the end of our mustard seed story. And I need to disappear because next I have to sing. But first of all, we have some mustard chocolate frogs. No. Well, you can pick that up for me, Caden. I'm sure you can bend down far better than I can. Right. Do you want to take a couple and just one? Okay. Would Amelia like one? And don't forget afterwards, if you're desperate for a marshmallow, we have plenty. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Katrina. That was a really boppy song. I wish we all could have sung the last chorus. Our Bible reading today is from Mark chapter 4, verses 26. The parable of the growing seed. He also said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain. First the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come." And then the parable of the mustard seed. Again he said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest seed you plant in the ground. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all the garden plants, with such big branches that the birds of the air can perch in its shade." With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. But when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. Amen.
Well, it is our turn to sing again, and we're singing "I Serve a Risen Saviour." However, that singer's piece is now in my head, and I'm trying to sing "I Serve a Risen Saviour" to that tune. It's not working. My head is not, it's hurting actually. So we're going to sing this together. I'm going to invite you to stand. We're speaking about the kingdom of God. We're speaking about the reality of life and to know that the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed with so much potential. And that potential is seen in our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. So I invite everybody to stand. We're going to sing it straight through all three verses. My mic's. Sorry, Howard. I like that one though. I was thinking, I know that song. That's not this one though. That's a beautiful song too. Let's try that again.
I see the tent of God.
It's always lovely hearing you singing, and it's really great when the band sings. There's a whole little choir department happening over there. Can you guys like play and sing at the same time? Yeah, can we work on that, please? Just give it a go. All right, let's pray. Lord God, we pray today for your servant Peter as he comes to share his words with us today. Lord, we pray that we see through him and hear you. Lord, pray that whatever it has been placed on his heart to come to us, that our ears be open, our eyes be willing to see, and our hearts be willing to receive what it is that you have to say. Lord, it is us that have unrealized potential, because your potential is already realized. We thank you for all that you do for us already, but Lord, we ask and expect more. So be present, be tangibly present throughout this word, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. How are we? We good? Live? Well? Here? Excellent. Very good. All right. I have always had a very terrible thing to do. I love to see how things work, all right? And the worst tool in my hands is a set of screwdrivers. Anything breaks at home? Yep. Instead of throwing it out like my wife would prefer, it comes apart in pieces. Out comes the screwdriver set. I pull it apart with, you know, the weird thought that I could actually fix it. But more, I just want to know what's inside, how it works, what makes it turn, what fun there could be. And look, there are times where I'm lucky and it works again. It's pretty good. I don't know how, but it does. Other times, there's just a pile of junk, number of screwdrivers, bits and pieces, a bag of screws, which I think I'm going to keep for next time, bits of wires that I think, hey, you never know. Come on, guys, you all know exactly what I'm talking about. Goes in a box in the bottom of the cupboard, never to be used again. But I enjoy pulling it apart. It's fun. I've pulled apart everything from, and I brought this one up because I had to explain to Madison what it was. You pulled apart a Walkman, and I had to explain what that was. So those in the room have never used a Walkman. It's a thing that has a tape in it. You used to listen to music. You didn't have Spotify. You had to listen to an actual tape. And then I was pulled apart VHS, which then I had to explain that one again, what a VHS tape was. It's like a bigger version of one of those. I pulled apart TVs, anything that had a set of screws, and I pulled it apart. It's what I did. And then once you pull it apart, you start getting curious, and you start seeing, I wonder how this works. You start connecting things to things you probably shouldn't have connected things to. I don't know. It happens. Numerous pieces get thrown away. There's a lot of oops. Never electrocuted myself, so that's pretty good. But there was a lot of things that fall apart. There's a lot of messes. But it's good to know how things work. That's what I feel as though I needed to do and learn. But then you start wondering, I wonder what happens if I do this? I wonder what happens if I try this? I have had something explode on me before, but that's okay. I've still got 10 fingers and a couple of, that's all good. But then I start thinking a bit more. And if you've never watched, my favourite show is Mythbusters. And I kind of think, I wonder what would happen if I gave this a go. So I want to start small first, and then I want to work up some big things, all right? I was going to do some stuff, and then Erica said it's probably not wise. There's probably some people with issues that don't like certain things. I did a experiment in a congregation before with a balloon, and I had someone run out of the building because they don't like balloons. So imagine this, okay. So a water balloon. As a kid, you fill it up. As an adult and as a dad teaching your kids, you fill up a water balloon to its supposed capacity. Then you thought, I wonder how big I can make this. You know what happens. It goes bang. And then you thought, well, if a water balloon can go that big, how big can a normal balloon go filled with water? They go pretty big, actually. It's pretty fun. And then I thought, I wonder what happens if you try and fill up those balloons you make balloon animals with water. That doesn't go well. They don't fill up very well at all. They pop before you can do anything with it. And then you think of the practical joke of shaking a can and giving it to someone. Now, I've done that here. I'm not going to do that again. But you shake it up, and I thought, I wonder how long you can shake it and keep shaking it and whether it makes any difference. It doesn't. It all goes bang and you get a big mess. But then I was trying to think, what are some of the bigger things that I've done in this space? And growing up, and while I was at high school, we used to do archery. And the teacher is teaching you how to do the thing. You pull it back this far and let it go, and you wonder, I wonder how much further. You know, when you get to a certain point, and you go, I wonder if I can go a bit further, and it starts doing this. And you start thinking, that's probably not a really good idea. When I was even after high school, I went to the PCYC and I had an opportunity to fire an air rifle. And that's loads of fun. The guy teaching you says pump it 3 times and you go, that was pretty easy. And you thought, I wonder if I can go to 5. I wonder if I can go to 7. If you've ever used an air rifle, by the time you get to about 7, you're like squeezing the daylights out of it. You shoot it off and it makes a very loud bang, and then you have the guy who was teaching you come over and go, you do that again and I'll be calling your parents. So it started from a very young age of what can I do and can I make it go bigger? It still goes on now, unfortunately. Just have a chat with Erica afterwards about some stupid things you get up when you're showing your kids things you shouldn't do. But that's all right. The idea that I want to teach or get out today is that we have so much in our world. And when we put effort into something, we get more out on the other side of things. I'm not going to go into a science lesson. But as we go into our scripture today, and as the children's story so easily highlighted and took some of my thunder away, but that's all right, we have the seeds of a farmer. And it says here in the scriptures, and I'm paraphrasing to make it easier, that the farmer sows his seeds, and whether he sleeps or he's awake, day or night, the seed sprouts and grows. All by itself, it grows from a stalk to the head into a full kernel. The seed does what the seed was created to do. But how does the seed do that? Back in the scriptures, when it was written, the farmer knew that when he threw the seeds out, it would grow. That he threw it in good soil or bad soil, it would grow. And it was up to where he threw it, and what happened was up to the seed. Then we got curious, and we thought, what's in a seed? So scientists and others cut the seed in half. Some of it actually took time to put the seed in some soil and record what happens and write it down. And now, if you go and Google how does a seed grow, you can watch YouTube clips for hours over how seeds grow. In slow motion, we can see how it unfolds, it grows, it roots, it seeds, and it grows into a nice plant that it is. But we used to know nothing about it. It just happened. But then we started enjoying the love of what I have of pulling things apart, seeing how it works. And then we thought, how can we make it go bigger? So we started introducing stuff into soil. We started making fertilizer. We started to be able to get food and feed the plants and make them bigger and stronger and better. We started looking for help. We started looking for ways that we can make it all bigger and better and help a seed along. We kind of forgot that the mechanics of the seed would work whether we put input into it or not. Whether we understood botany or biology, you put a seed in some soil, it'll do what it does, it'll grow. The seed of any plant, no matter what, it'll do what it was intended to do. We have no real need for our input into the seed. If you want an example, just think of Erica's lily sitting on there doing nothing, and it just grows. We didn't water it, it just grew. Who knows? But nature takes care of what nature needs to take care of. The seed will fall, the seed will land, the seed will grow, and then it will become what it was meant to be, a bush, a shrub, or a massive tree. Each seed has its own potential. It has its own readiness to grow and do what it needs to do. When we look at what the mustard seed is in our scripture today, it's probably one you've heard of so many times. But the mustard seed is one of the smallest seeds that grows into the largest plant relative to its size. So if you see a mustard tree, it would probably fill the stage if it grows. It's not an overly large plant, but from a small seed, it grows into a relatively big plant. The idea that inside this little tiny seed, if you remember that mustard jar seed, you can have a look afterwards, it's over there. It is tiny, and out of that is a plant, is a seed that is ready just to explode no matter what. The whole scripture here is to remind us that each and every one of us has that unrealized potential within ourselves. Just like the little seed, there is no input that is really needed. Yes, we go to school. We learn the things that we need to learn around the world. We need to know what we need to do for our jobs, for our roles. But inside of us is God's potential. In that space is the biggest, greatest thing ready to emerge. We sit there sometimes and think, it's not until I know everything that I can be useful. It's not until I've learnt everything that I need to know, that I need to know how it works. I need to know all the answers. We need to have it all sorted out before we think we're able to use it. Jesus was referring to the mustard seed as it is just a small seed, as it is, as he created. We too are created from nothing. Through God's love, he continues to create in us every day, that we grow both physically and spiritually. As we mature and grow into what he created us to be, we become larger than what we started. We're able to grow and show potential. The kingdom of God does not happen by force. Like a seed, it'll grow. But as we do what the kingdom of God is working in our lives, as we express that outside, we become that unrealized potential in the world around us. You are a mustard seed. You will do what God needs you to do if we recognize our potential inside of us. I'm going to put on a song for you to listen to today. It's a song I've used before, and I just want you to sit and listen to the clip, sing it if you know it. It's a song called Do Something by Matthew West. And his opening part of the song is like this. I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble and thought, how are we ever going to get so far down? How are we ever going to turn it around? I turned my eyes to heaven, and I thought, God, why don't you do something? And he says here at the last part of this that God did. God turned around and said, I did something. I created you. In us is the potential that God created. And as people, as children of God, we have that potential inside of us to do what the kingdom of heaven needs to get done. I'm not going to stand up here. I'm going to play the music and sit down. And you guys just envelop into the words that is said in here as it gets sung. And take a time to realize your potential inside.
I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble. Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I
just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you. If not us, then who?
Sharing you, it was about doing something in expectations, and I shared with you about the bow and arrow. A bow and arrow will be a bow and arrow on the floor. It's what it is. There's a bow, there's an arrow, but if it lays on the floor, it'll just remain there on the floor. But if you pick it up and draw it back, great things can happen. The potential that is in there, and I think that we can able to do stuff for others around us. We can do stuff as the kids, the children of God, as our potential is in there, draw back and let it go and see what happens. We are full of God's potential. We need to let it loose. I invite you to stand as we're going to sing our song, which says, stand up for Jesus. Soldiers of the cross, lift high his royal banner. If not, I must not suffer loss from victory to victory. And Christ is Lord indeed. If we do what we need to do within the power of God, we will see great things happen. So let's stand as we sing this song together. Verses 1 and 2, please, Dave. Stand up for Jesus. Stand up in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you. You dare not trust your own. Put on salvation armor and watch unto prayer. Where duty calls for danger, be never wanting there. Stand up for Jesus. The strife will not be long. This day of noise of battle, the next the victor's song. Amen. To him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory will reign eternally. Amen. This is the God we're singing. This is the God that gives us all the potential we need. We just need to let it loose. Let's sing verses 3 and 4. Is a mustard seed of faith ready to explode into a massive tree. Whether it has or whether it needs encouragement again, allow God to be your encouragement for that growth. So praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, you heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, who finds us and loves us where we are. God bless you all. Have a great day.